There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away.
Hey, welcome to Waterway. I am so glad that you're here today. My name is Jesse. I'm one of the pastors, and we're going to have a really fun worship service today. We have a few of our missionaries who are in town, and we're going to be hearing from them. We have a number of people who are becoming members of our church today, and you're going to hear from them. And then after our worship service, we've got a lunch that's been prepared, and you're all invited. You didn't have to bring anything. You didn't even have to know about it until just now. But you're invited to stick around for lunch if you'd like to. We're going to be focusing on some of the mission work that we support, where that happens in the world. And this is just sort of a celebration and a recognition of that. But welcome. I'm glad you're here. What we're going to do from now and for the next 75 minutes or so is we're going to worship God together. So welcome to worship. If you would, while we get ready to sing this first song, I'm going to invite you to stand up and shake each other's hands. But here's your first instruction. You're very quick, Matthew, but here's your first instruction. If you are in a long row and you're sitting out toward the edges, why don't you say hello to the people that are on either end and kind of move to the middle, because there's a number of people that are going to be coming in and they need seats. I'd rather them not climb over you. So just kind of move to the middle of the row. If you can, stand up, say hello, greet each other. Welcome to worship.
You lived, you died, you said in 3 days you would rise. You did, you're alive. You rule, you reign, you said you're coming back again. I know that you will. Sing your praises.
You take our sins away, oh God.
You take our sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. And our hearts are changed because of your great love. You lived, you died, you said in 3 days you would rise. You did.
Amen. You may be seated.
Morning, church. Morning. Lots going on today. But let's start opening the word to Psalm 25, 4 through 7. Please join me as I read these words. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me. For you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. These few verses, it's a simple reminder that we don't always walk in God's ways sometimes. David was troubled here. And you read through this psalm later in the psalm. He says, I am lonely and afflicted. And there are times when our paths go separate from the ways of God. So David was asking God to show him and guide him in his ways because his own life was sometimes marked by sin and rebellion. Not a pleasant place to be in. So the sermon today, Jesse's going to be talking from Psalms 42 and the challenge of keeping hope and faith alive when one feels downcast or disturbed. Juxtapositions of God's ways and ours, of faith and being disturbed, may feel like too much for us to handle sometimes. But these psalms remind us that God can deal with everything we deal with. We just need to turn to Him and to trust in Him. It very much reflects what we covered in Jeremiah 29 in Sunday school this morning. And it reminds me of Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Could we just take a minute to pray silently and ask God to fill our hearts, be present here. Lord God in heaven, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you will show us your awesome wonders, Lord. And we just ask, Lord, that you would fill each one of us every person in this place with your presence this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So, lots going on, announcements. Be sure to check the screen that scrolls before the service, if you think about it, and you'll see a lot what's going on. There's Jesse Messon, a lunch today. So let's do that. Everybody be there. I'm just saying. Why not? this is Mission Sunday, so our mission and outreach team has a mission statement, and it is doing our part to fulfill the Great Commission and the Second Commandment. And there's many different ways they go about accomplishing this. One of the more substantial ways is our giving to the other ministries and missionaries. So in your bulletin, you would have seen a long list of missions we support each month and missionaries we support on the back there. And I love this church that gives so much of God's resources to supporting other missions, to spreading the gospel. I think that's a good thing. So the missions, we're highlighting the five missionaries we are supporting. Charles and Anne-Marie Smoker in Japan with Glints. George and Mardell Landis serving in Northern Africa with Frontiers. Devin and Katie Breckbill in Southeast Asia with Pioneers. And Randy Umble in Mexico with Reach Beyond. And also Bryce Engel will be supporting as he serves in East Asia for 13 months. There's a table out in the lobby that has information for each of our missionaries. Check it out. And so right now, Randy Umble is here, and I think he's going to come up and say a little something.
Thank you. Well, it's good to be here. Thank you so much for welcoming our family. And I'd like to just introduce my family to you. So you can wave, I guess. They're just right here. you don't have to stand up or do a dance or anything. So my wife, Melanie, and our sons, David and Eric, are with us. We have a daughter, Katie, who's on her way to Maryland with MDS today. So she's not here. And then our son, John, and daughter-in-law, Maddie, they just got married in May. They live in Washington State, and our other daughter, Natalie, also lives in Washington State. You all have been supporting our family through your prayers and finances for many, many years, probably longer than some of you have actually been here. And some of you might not have no idea who you're praying for or who you're partnering with. So it is good to be able to be here and at least show our faces and thank you in person, because we are very, very grateful. As many of you know, the reason we are in the United States right now is because of my health. Back in October 21 is when I got my first symptoms of kidney failure. For the second time, 12 years ago, I had a transplant, and you all prayed with us during that time, and you've continued to pray during this time. We moved to the United States in January of 2022 and are continuing to wait for a compatible kidney for me so I can have a transplant, or if God chooses to heal me, that would be even better. In my way of thinking, I'm on summer break as a teacher, and so now would be the perfect time to have a transplant and recovery before we start school again. And that brings me into some of the ministries that we're involved in. So while we were in Ecuador and in Mexico, We were involved in missionary supporting mission work through missionary kid education, through teaching and helping out at a school. Most recently in Oaxaca Christian School, where I teach Bible. And the good thing about the technology we have available to us is, even though I was here in the U.S., I was able to continue to teach a couple Bible classes via Zoom. And so that's part of what we were doing this past year. And we're also involved with ministry with Reach Beyond, who is our sending mission. I help out with a program which is called Share English. And it is, in my opinion, a really great program. It's a very creative way of sharing the gospel with people that might not hear otherwise. And so if I just briefly share a little bit about that, it started off very, very small as a way of teaching English to people in Ecuador. And it has, right now, it is just all over the world. There are groups of people who have clubs set up where they bring people who want to learn English. And so our team produces programs to sort of help people think about, well, they're different topics, and so it's like ways of speaking. Kind of hard to explain, but trust me, it's a really great thing. And I'm not involved with the production, but what I do is I check the comments on the website and also check the emails. And if one of the cool thing that's been happening, I say cool, I don't like that term, but one thing that I really have been enjoying is there was a comment made about this show, and this guy just said, well, I'm really lonely, basically. And so I contacted him over email directly, and I kind of reached out to him a little bit, and he's someone who has read the Bible and had a lot of questions, and I've been able to go back and forth with him. I'm praying that he's going to come to know Jesus through this. I don't know if he will or not. But there's other, I guess the reason I bring that up is because sometimes you might not know how you can be involved in missions here besides your prayers and financial giving, which, I mean, those are very, very important. You also could be involved because of internet. You can contact people all over the world. And there are programs. I know Reach Beyond has a project called the Ephraim Project, which uses social media to reach out to people and share the gospel with them. So there's lots of opportunities. After the service, I'm going to be out there at the lobby. So if you have questions specifically of how you could be involved, I'd be happy to share that with you. I think that's all I really had to say as far by way of update. Very, very basic. If you have questions, again, you can ask me. I did fail at when I introduced my family. I forgot to say, I'm sorry. We also have my in-laws are here visiting as well. They are missionaries in Ecuador. They've been there for over 50 years. So if you want, say hi to them too. So anyways, thank you again for your prayers and support of my family.
Thanks, Randy. Thanks, Randy. Bryce Engel, is he here? Also.
Hello, everyone. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Bryce Engel. I grew up here at Medial Waterway. I just finished my sophomore year in college, and I'm getting ready to go to my junior year of college, which for me means I'm going to be living for 13 months in Southeast Asia. a long, crazy story of how I got to that point in my life, which I will be, I believe, sharing more in 2 weeks with Jesse. But for now, just to give kind of an insight into what I'm getting into, I've been attending college in the great Arctic tundra of the Midwest called Minnesota, and I've been studying intercultural ministry and transformational entrepreneurship, just big fancy words. I've been learning intercultural ministry, missions for that word, in the context of business, how that's used to create value in people, specifically in unreached areas. And so what that looks like for me for my schooling is for 13 months, I get to go and have a immersive experience in what it looks like to live overseas in an unreached area doing unreached missions as part of my schooling. So I will be living in Indonesia for 13 months alongside workers who have been serving there as missionaries for over a decade. And they've all started small businesses and employ people there. And basically, I get to just do life there and learn under them while still taking classes online for school. And I'm really excited to kind of get that kind of experience of what it looks like to be very relationship focused in how you engage with the culture. The culture is completely Muslim, so it's a very very different culture than what we're all used to. And so, being able to create friendships and create just your network of people, as well as plug into the ministries and the networks that our leaders have set up there as they've been there. There's a lot of opportunity, whether that's just being consistent and going to the same coffee shop and getting to know your barista then and things like that, but also plugging into the ministries that they have there, which for me would look like working in anti-trafficking safe houses that they've set up there, which is a huge issue in Asia. And so, yeah, I'm excited to kind of go and have that kind of learning experience, but also doing experience at the same time. I will be out in the lobby if you want to talk more about it. Come up and ask me all about it. And you can also sign up for my newsletter out there as well. I really appreciate, as I've, over the past few months, been building up support and getting ready for this, I've really appreciated just the way that this is my home base. And I can lean on all of you with your prayer and support. It is such a blessing. And so I'm really grateful for you all for being that. I will be excited to update you all as I go about all of this. So thank you.
Thanks, Royce. That is so cool. So we're going to be praying for our missionaries, but first, there's a few announcements, and I am like all over the place here with my stuff. There are two births in our church family, RE Troop. Yeah, I lost everything. I think it's back in my seat. Oh, here it is. RE Troop was born July 3rd, and also he was born to Avery and Emma Troop. Also, to Matt and Kristen Adams, we had Grady born on June 26th. So, praises there. Today, we're going to be welcoming some new people into our congregation. So Jesse's going to be doing that later. Pay attention to that. Prayer request, Jonathan Alderfer, surgery on Monday to remove tonsils and adenoids. I've never had that done. I don't know what it's like, but I did hear somewhere that ice cream is involved, so hopefully that comes true. Please pray for, we're going to be praying for all our missionaries. Elaine Staunton, please keep her in your prayers for hip pain. Jim Herr, this cancer. Phil and Elaine Herzog are still dealing with problems, John Coverley, and also Patty Robinson as she continues cancer treatment. Pay attention to, if you would, please, to these prayer requests and lift these people up during the week. Let's go to prayer. Lord God, we just thank you that we can meet together and we can sing praises to you, we can worship you, and we can do this freely. We have a great privilege. Lord, we just lift up our missionaries, the Landis family. Lord, we just ask that you would work your healing powers on George's kidneys and just be a blessing to that family. We also lift up the Smoker family in Japan. Lord God, be with them and show them your paths. Show them your ways. We also lift up Randy Umble. I'm sorry, I messed that up. Randy is getting the kidney issue, and I just ask Father that you would be with Randy and his family as they work through this issue and be his healer. Also lift up Devin and Katie Breckville in Southeast Asia with Pioneers, Lord. Be with them, guide them, and show them your will. Lord, we thank you for these two births in this in our family, and we just ask, Father, that you would guide these families and give them the support they need through this church and also, Lord, we just lift up Jonathan Alderfer as he goes to surgery this week. Be with that family, be with the doctors. Also, Lord, we just pray for each of those who are struggling with health issues. We think of Elaine, Phil and Elaine Herzog and John Coverley. Pray, Lord, for Jim Herr and just Patty Robinson, and just ask, Father, that you would comfort and heal each one as you see fit. Lord, we thank you for the Hope Christian Center in the Bronx, and we just thank you, Lord, for the work that they're doing. We ask, Father, that that people would seek out that that establishment and see the work that they are doing to spread the gospel. Lord, also we think of Gavin Landis, who's had some minor eye surgery and it turned into a cataract, and now they're not sure what to do, and he's just such a young man, Lord. To have to go through this, Lord, we would just ask for your healing strength there in the Landis family and for direction for the doctors and for George and Mardell. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for all that you have given us, all that you will give us. We thank you, Lord, that you are a God of hope. And in you we find joy and peace as we trust in you. And in fact, we can overflow with hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Standing.
Stand with us once again as we gather in our time of worship and song. I'm going to start out with, I lift my hands. We praise a God who is a healer, who has the ability to heal us. He gives us his mercy. Let's praise Jesus this morning.
Be still, there is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms are fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to believe again. You are my refuge, you are my strength.
All who are weak,
come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come Lord Jesus, come Lord Jesus, come Lord Jesus, come Lord Jesus, come Holy Spirit.
Jesus.
song's touching me this morning too. This last song we're gonna sing, it's What a Savior. What a Savior we sing about this morning. What he's done for us, the atoning sacrifice to take away our sins. Sing this last song with us. What a Savior.
Atoning sacrifice, keeper of this life, hallelujah, you are Savior, beginning and the end, forgiver of my sin, by your mercy, you have saved us. Jesus, you are stronger, more than any other. Hallelujah, you are Savior. Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You are the Shepherd King, by still waters, hallelujah, you are Savior, you are my only hope, your kindness is my friend, in your presence you restore us. Jesus, you are stronger, more than any other. Savior, Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are my joy and my salvation. Stood in my place, taking my shame. Stronger, more than any other. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Jesus, you are higher, my soul's deepest desire. Hallelujah, you are Savior. Hallelujah, you are Savior.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We give it all to you. Thank you for being our Savior. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning again, church. Church is one of those words that is kind of loaded, has a lot of different meanings and different ways of being spoken and different things that we might intend to say when we use the word church. I am a boy who grew up in church. That was just part of how my family operated. Sunday mornings came and it was time to go to church. And what that meant when I was a little boy was that we would go and we went to a church called the Mechanic Grove Church of the Brethren, about 15 miles from here. And I went to my Sunday school class, and then after Sunday school was church, right? We would have a worship service, kind of like this one. Different style, but the same idea, gathering together, singing and praying, being together, hearing a sermon, listening to the Bible being taught. And that was church, right? As a little boy, how many of you know that kind of story, right? As I got a little bit older, we talked sometimes about, other than Sunday morning, well, we're going to the church because there were activities and there was youth stuff and junior high stuff. So the church was not just an activity on Sunday morning, but the church was a building. It was a place that we went to. And in fact, it was really easy because there was a sign out front that said church. So now the layers were starting to build in my life, right? And as I got older and I heard this call into ministry, and for myself, church almost became part of my identity, as in this is kind of my job. I work for the church, at the church, with the church, to help the church. And it's all the same word, but there's different stuff in there, right? And even now, as you sit here, we have different ideas about how we are engaged with the church. Some of you say, well, I'm part of the church because I'm here right now. Some of you, you're watching us online and it's Sunday afternoon or Monday morning or Thursday night, and so you're feeling like you're having church. Have you ever said it that way? There's all these different layers. And in fact, even in the Bible, in the New Testament, the word church is used in a couple of different ways, but it's all pointing in the same direction. There is an intention to be close to God. And a really good basic definition of church would be a gathered group of people who believe in Jesus and are saved by him and are working together then in God's purposes. That's another really rich way, I think, of talking about the church. And so today, just for a moment here, we're going to invite a few people forward who are deciding to become members of this church. What does that mean? Well, here's what it means. We've got a Sunday morning worship service right now that everybody's welcome to, and everyone is invited to. And we all come together and we worship and sing and praise, and in fact, we record it and we put it online so that others have the ability to worship along, even if Sunday morning or our location is not a possibility for them. So in some ways, we are doing church now. But once or twice a year, we have a series of classes. We call them Explorers classes or Exploring Membership classes. And we had the last series of these in the spring. And what that means is that everybody who's not already a church member is invited to come and learn more about Waterway Church. What is this place about? What do we believe? How do we think about things? How do we do our business? How do we organize ourselves? How do we teach and lead and structure and do all that stuff that kind of manifests itself often on Sunday mornings, but really happens a lot behind the scenes with gifted, committed people practicing and planning and preparing, supporting and praying, so that together we can bring our sacrifice of praise to God. And so here this spring, we had an exploring membership class of about 25 people. And today, we're going to meet a few people who have been part of other churches in the past, but now because they've moved or because life situations have changed or because they've just been here for a long time and they felt like it was time to make a commitment, these people who have already been baptized in the Lord and who have been believers and Christians for a long time, they are making a commitment to certainly God's church, but to this local church here at Waterway. And we're going to hear from them in just a moment. But what I'd like to let you all know about and let you all remember is that from time to time, we do have these Explorers classes, and it's a great chance to learn more about what is really happening behind the scenes. What goes into all the stuff that we're trying to do, and why do we do it? That's what our Exploring Membership classes are about, and these people have said we're in. Now, what's super exciting, not at all to minimize what's happening today, but on July 30th and on August 6th, so 3 and 4 weeks from now, on both of those Sundays, we're going to be having baptism services because there are a number of people, almost 15 of them, who were in that Explorers class this spring who have said, kind of for the first time, I believe in Jesus. I'm giving my life to Jesus. I want to follow him, and now I want to be baptized. And they're going to become part of the church as well. But honestly, that's where the real juice is. I mean, that's what is really exciting. To see people becoming a member of the church is wonderful. But to see people becoming a member of God's universal church, knowing that their lives are saved, that Jesus is working on them, that they're filled with the Holy Spirit, that's exciting. So mark your calendars. You're going to want to be here right immediately after our worship services on July 30th and on August 6th. We're going to be doing those baptisms. But it's all kind of pointing to this idea of church. And so we do always rejoice when individuals make a decision and a commitment to walk their faith with this fellowship, but most of all, we're excited that people are walking with God. So today, we're going to celebrate the commitment to the Lord and a decision to become a member at Waterway Church for a number of folks, and I'm going to invite them to come forward. I see the Hoffmans are here and some Johnsons, and I think Betsy is here, and so, and if I've missed anybody, well, you guys just come up forward too. But these are people who have been through these membership classes. I'm going to invite you to come up here and join me up here on the top. And what we always do, and this is especially if you're kind of maybe new with us and still figuring out what this church is all about. As I said, come on over, guys. Can you navigate? Dennis, you're a pretty good driver, right? There you go. Come on over. Go ahead, Amy. And so Dennis and Amy Hoffman and Kathy and Bill Johnson and Betsy Huber have all come to this place today, and they are all so excited to share their story with you. But that's what they're going to do. We call them testimonies when that's here at church, right? And what I challenge them to do, and what you're going to hear from the people who get baptized in a couple of weeks, and some of those folks, some junior high kids, some people who are really new to the fellowship, they are super excited to stand in front of all of you and tell their stories. But what I've requested and what we've asked is just for each person to give us, hey, how did you come to believe in God? And why do you figure that now is the time to commit to Waterway Church? That's what I've asked them to think about, and I'm going to grab you guys a microphone. Chad, where would I find? Here it is. All right. And I'm going to move the pulpit to the side unless any of you need it to hide behind or put your papers on. But Dennis, would you share a bit of your story and your testimony with us?
Sure. I got to tell you, it's different speaking in front of everybody, so I've come up with a great idea that you guys, instead of looking at me, pick something else to look at. I don't know if you want to look at Jesse, you want to but don't look at them. No.
Don't look at Dennis.
Yeah, okay, don't look at me.
Shut your eyes.
I'm not here. All right, well, I grew up in a Catholic family that was really, we said we were Catholics, but we never went to church. We never did any of that growing up. And as I grew up and got into the teens and that, I ran into an addiction problem that really just took over a big chunk of my life that I just couldn't shake. As I got married and my wife and I started going to church and that, and in the beginning, that's I was more or less just taking up a pew. I wasn't really, I was just for the family.
You got your verse stolen. Oh, I hate when that happens, Dennis.
My wife, I got
we could share. We can all share a thunder.
Hopped into this church, and my wife and I, we do, you know, we do a devotion where we study something in the morning, pray for every morning. So the one morning, we prayed, we got ready for church, we come in, sat down over on the side, and the message that day was on kingdom marriage. So we got in the car and we said, okay, where the Holy Spirit wants us to go. That's pretty clearly written. So that's how we ended up here. And
The rest is history. Welcome, Dennis. Thank you so much for sharing your story. Amy, would you share your testimony with us?
I am so proud of him. He was very nervous.
Well, I couldn't tell. I wasn't looking at him. So I I thought he sounded all right.
Funny thing is I prepared my testimony on paper, you know? And he's like, seriously, you're going to read that? And he goes, all these years I've been married to you, you've had salvation, and everybody we meet, you somehow, where did you go to church? Where did you go to marry? He said, you fit it in somehow. And so I'm not going with my little script here, but I was afraid that I'd be a loss of words, because I don't know if you guys are gamers, but hanging around with me, you have to play charades, because I don't know what happens to my words. I don't know if it's an age thing, stress thing, but I just go blank. And Dennis goes, yeah. So anyways, here it goes. My family took us to church. We were a family of four siblings. And we went to church every Sunday. And I remember my brothers used to get pins, you know, if they attended church all the time. And here's something for all you Sunday school teachers that feel like no gratification of teaching these young children Sunday school. I want to tell you, you're looking at a 63-year-old that, if it wasn't for her Sunday school teacher, not much what she taught me was how much she loved me. And she always knew me by name. And I eventually grew up in a house. My mother was a severe alcoholic. And church just dwindled away. But God always seemed to put people in my life that were mentors. And it started with that Sunday school teacher. And as I grew up, it was somebody else. And so I was really lucky for the Lord to just come into my heart as a young child. Some people believe in free will. Some people believe in Calvinism. I give up on all that, trying to figure it out. But God loved me, and he came into my life as a young child. And I remember sitting on the couch and always being so inquisitive about the Lord, and I just prayed to God. His family. But that didn't mean when I grew up that I didn't become a teenager and sin, but something changed. I would always have a conscience of my sin. And then I was 18 years old when I got a devastating call. My best friend was killed. As you can see, it still chokes me. A drunk driver killed my friend. So I was so glad that the Lord came in my life earlier so I can handle it. From then on, I decided to pick up that Bible, and I read, and I got to know him in a personable way, not in just a conscious way or a guilty way, but a personable way. And that's how I pretty much live my life. We're not perfect Christians. We could sin yesterday, and I did at home or at Lowe's when I told the ignorant man to just walk away. I came home and I said, boy, I was really rude, but he was rude first. So we're not perfect Christians. I hope he's not here. But this is what you got. You got a family here with a bunch of imperfect people trying to learn, trying to live with Christ. And today I'm just asking for you to accept the Hoffmans. We got a lot of humor, got a lot of love. But I'm here to take a family. I didn't have much family growing up. We lost all her cousins, or anybody that knew us didn't want to come around us. So that's where I started going to church and really craving a family. So I ask you to just be my aunts, be my uncles, be my sisters. Mm. And my verse is, because I'm always anxious, because so many things happen in life. There was many more things than when I lost Margie. But God has always been beside me and helped me get through it. And I always say that game when you're young and it's Red Rover, Red Rover, and you challenge somebody to come over and you had to break the chain. Well, that's what life is. You can't go under it. You can't go over it. You got to go through it. And I need all of you. I need all of you in my life so I can get through it. My verse is in 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your anxieties on the Lord because he cares for you.
Okay. I do not like public speaking. I'm very different from my children. So I'm a little nervous. I didn't write anything down because I didn't know what to write down. So we'll just see what comes out. I grew up in a home, Christian home. I was the youngest of five. So of course I was a spoiled baby, which I got told a lot. But we went to Mechanic Grove Mennonite Church. I was there until we were married. I married Bill. He actually puts up with me. Actually, we've been married 50 years on Friday, so. It's been 50 years, but boy, they went fast. 50 good years. But, so I knew about Jesus. I knew about church. It was what I was taught. It was just the way it was. Went to church every week. But when I was 13, we had revival meetings. And I don't know if they were a week or 2 weeks, but one night sitting there singing Just As I Am, my heart was pounding like it is now. And I had to raise my hand. So that was in October, and then in April I was baptized. So went to church, no big difference of, that's just what we did. When we got married, we went to his church, which was Neffsville Mennonite Church, and we went when we felt like it, no big deal. We did get up Sunday morning and didn't feel like going, we didn't go. But then when children came along, we moved back down to the Quarryville area, and we thought, okay, we need to get serious about this. So, like I said, you know, it was just the way it was. You went to church. But as an adult, I didn't think I'd do this. Yeah. There are several incidences happened in my life that God has shown me he is real. And there's no doubt about it. I believe it. And if you're ever at a crossroads, just ask him and ask him and ask him again, what do I do? And after a bit, you're going to have a piece about it, and that's what you're supposed to do. It happened with a job already with me, which I thought, why would I do that? But, you know, it worked out, and that's where I was supposed to be. I had a cancer diagnosis at one point, and for 18 years I've been in remission. He's shown me himself again. So he's been good. He's blessed me more than I ever deserve. But, you know, when we believe in him, he blesses all of us more than we ever deserve if we get to go to heaven and be with him. And as a reason as to why we're here, we went to the Church of the Brethren for over 40 years. We were involved, we enjoyed it, good preaching. But you know, after a while, things change. It's set up different than it is here. We had Sunday school classes that were age-wise for adults instead of everyone together. And we loved our Sunday school class, but we just felt it's time to go. So during COVID, we felt that was the time to go because there was already a break. And so with all three of our children being here, where else would we go when churches opened up again? But the difference is there, I felt like I was going by habit. And here, I feel like it's worship.
Your turn.
I think I need something to lean on. Mm-hmm. And as I was thinking about this, I thought, well, what will I say? And so, God gave me the words this morning, and I thought I better write them down or I'll forget. I was saved after attending a George Brunk revival meeting in a tent along Route 30. It was near my home. It was a fire and brimstone message, and I know I did not want to spend eternity in hell. Over the years, Christ has become much more to me besides being my Savior. He is my God. My friend, someone I can always count on. I have some great mentors in the Bible that I could strive to follow. I try to have a faith like Job. What a man of God. But I also find myself like Peter. I can walk on water sometimes if I keep my eyes on Jesus. But I end up getting wet when I fail him. God is good all the time. He is in control, and I thank him. He has blessed me many, many times. This week, it was 50 great years. What a blessing. I wish to be more like Jesus. So I ask you all for your help, and I enjoy your comfort, your support, and I thank you. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen. And so just some of you don't know, Bill and Kathy are my mom and dad. And it's such a thrill to hear all of your stories so far. But mom and dad, thanks for sharing. Betsy, yeah. Would you share your story with us?
I have to follow them. So I was raised in a Baptist church over near Westchester, and I answered an altar call at age 8. So I grew up in the church. I was baptized when I was 13. And then after that, I was a Presbyterian for 50 years. In two different churches until the National Church strayed from the Bible, so I had to leave there. The Lord has been right beside me with me through many trials and tribulations and problems, family problems. I'm a widow for 17 years now. Especially in the last 8 years with my job, it's a lot of responsibility, a lot of stress. So he's the only way I could get through all that was with the Lord. Mm. And I've attended here, I think, for about 8 years. So I just thought it was about time I joined. And I do want to thank my small group for making me feel so welcome and being a part of this church family.
Amen. Thank you, Betsy. And so congregation, these folks have been through classes together and have gotten to know each other a little bit, but none of them have told their stories like that before. So thank you for sharing your stories. And what's amazing and powerful to me is that so many of you have stories to share too. And one of the blessings of being the church together is that we get to share those stories together. It takes time and it takes consistency to keep coming back and to stay engaged. But we get to keep sharing those stories and hearing how God is working. So thank you for sharing. A number of you have asked for our support and have asked for us to encourage you. And so I'm going to ask all of you three questions, and then we're going to have a response to you upon those answers, okay? So for the five of you, do you reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ and claim him as your Lord and Savior? If so, just say, I do. And as you unite with this church body, will you worship, serve, and share in our programs? And we support this church with your prayers, your attendance, your offerings, and your service as God gives you strength. If so, say, I will. And do you promise to live and share with us in Christian fellowship, giving and receiving Christian love, sharing in one another's joy and pain, offering and receiving counsel as needed? If so, would you say, I do? Good. Good. Congregation, would you stand with me? And especially for those of you who are members, would you please repeat these words on the screen as we share these commitments to the Hoffmans, the Johnsons, and to Betsy Huber? Church, would you read, "We welcome you with joy and affection into this household of faith. We pledge to you our help and our prayers so that we can become more like Jesus. We trust God for strength to follow with you in Christ's way. Amen." The members of this church have welcomed you in God's name, and I welcome you from the bottom of my heart. You have my promise that I will do all that I can by God's power to teach and encourage and lead you as you grow in your faith. What a blessing that we can do this together. Amen? Amen. You may be seated. So lunch is going to be ready at about 11:45, and I have 6 pages of a sermon right here, so get ready. Here we go. Now, here's what I want to do right now, and I want to take about 10 minutes. We're going to spend about 10 minutes here together, and then we will have lunch, and you can talk to missionaries, and we can talk together and share. But one quick announcement. I wanted to let you know that in the last 2 weeks, we've been through a process. Many of you have been praying for us as our church has been looking to hire a volunteer coordinator. Well, we have hired Debbie Hale to serve as our volunteer coordinator. Church, if you're on our email list, look for an email later this week with some more details and an introduction and just some talk about how that goes. But please pray for Debbie as she joins our staff here at Waterway Church. And Debbie's here in the back. Today she's not serving on our computer team as she often does, but Debbie's been attending our fellowship here for a good while. And so just want to welcome Debbie to the team. Again, you'll hear some more about that. But today, the sermon that was prepared was on Psalm 42. And we're just going to review this together through the screen. Would you read this along with me? "As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Where can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, 'Where is your God?' These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep in the roar of your waterfalls. All your waves and breakers have swept over me. By day, the Lord directs his love. At night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to my God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, 'Where is your God?' Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." I don't know if your experience is anything like mine, but life is a mixed bag. We read this just now in this psalm, written 3,000 years ago by the sons of Korah. This psalm was written to be lyrics for a song that would be sung in worship. And do you recall what you just read? Deep statements of faith, for sure. You are my God, you are my strength. Deep cries out to deep. Why must I fear? Why must I be afraid? And yet, do you hear the yearning, the longing, and the pain? "As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God." Thirst isn't just something like, boy, I'm just a little bit thirsty, but this thirst, this picture of I have been in a desert and I am dying. Water is not just a luxury, it is a necessity, right? And here in this psalm, we hear this crying out, "God, I need you like that." So there's this statement of faith and there's this acknowledgement that, "God, I need you," but there is this admission, "Why, soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed?" My soul is downcast. And what I love about Psalm 42 and what I'm going to invite you to think about and what we're going to circle back around on over and over and over this summer is that no matter what we feel, because sometimes we do feel downcast. Sometimes we do feel like, I don't want to go to church today. You heard people up here saying there were times that they were living kind of with God, but not always feeling it. That's how it is, right? I mean, in the last week, think about what you've done since the very last time that you were here. When Caleb Cunningham shared his testimony last week, do you recall? What's happened since then? That was July 2nd. What was your 3rd and your 4th like? You remember some of the events? Do you remember where you were? This week I had a 21st wedding anniversary. Melanie and I are married 21 years on Thursday. We celebrate, hey, thank you. And last night we celebrated along with my mom and dad their 50th anniversary, and family was together. And we had some great celebrations and good food and good times. But I'll tell you, in the last 7 days, I've had some hard times too. Even in the midst of all that stuff, there's a couple things that, like, relationally were really different that now I can see they're working out and we're getting there, but it was hard. And not just like, oh, it's kind of a sad day, but like, no, I don't want to face these next couple hours kind of hard. And I thought, I woke up this morning and I just felt like I didn't have anything in the tank. I don't know, maybe it was too big of a week. But this morning I woke up and it's almost strange to admit it, but I woke up and I said, God, could you just please get me through to this afternoon? You ever feel like that when you go to work? Some of you felt that way when you woke up this morning too. Isn't this our experience? Don't we see this so often? Even when we are plugged in with God, the feelings come and go. They rise and fall. You who are missionaries, you see this. You are following God with all of your heart. You who are families of those who are professionally missionaries. It's just always happy, isn't it? No. I mean, God's provision is sure and God's foundation is strong and we can lean on him. Just as the psalmist says, why am I so downcast? Put my hope in God. I will praise him, my Savior and my God. But life is hard. Even in the midst of deep faith, life is hard. Amidst the joy and amidst the real happiness that we do enjoy at times, there are struggles and pain and there is difficulty. And this is why we don't base our lives. We can't base our lives on what we feel. Our feelings are real, and we acknowledge them. And if our feelings get so deep and so dark and so difficult that they are stopping us from functioning, then you need to talk to a pastor or a counselor and work through those things. You may need medication to deal with some of those things because feelings are not just emotions. Sometimes these are connected to our physicality and our chemistry. But what's being talked about here is generally just hard times, bad times here in Psalm 42. And what is the refrain that comes back over and over and over? My soul is downcast within me. Therefore, God, I will remember you. From the land of the Jordan, the heights of the Hermon, from Mount Mizar, God, I will remember you. Why, soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? See, this psalmist knows that there are times that we're disturbed. Jesus had times when he was disturbed. Jesus, who walked on this earth perfectly, whose relationship with God was never shaken, Jesus still in the garden, knelt down, prayed while his friends slept. He sweat drops of blood. Jesus knows this despair too, just like you and I do. And yet, what is the refrain here in Psalm 42? Soul, put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Church, that's the message. I hope that's what you heard today as Randy shared a little bit about what's happening in his life as he's a missionary giving his life to serving God and yet having to wait on a kidney again. Shouldn't it be easier than that if I'm serving God? We ask these questions. And yet sometimes we just have to lean on our faith and say, but I know God is good, even though my feelings and my circumstances seems like a mess. We hear Bryce talking, he's getting ready to have an amazing year, but I can guarantee you these next 13 months, as many highs as there are going to be, Bryce, are there going to be challenges? There are going to be difficulties. There are going to be struggles. And as much fun as it is to be away from home and in a different place, there will be times where your heart will pine for the comfort of home. Those of us who have kind of committed our professions and our careers to following the Lord, there are incredible blessings and there are deep, deep pains because we walk these things with you. And so together with the psalmist, all of us need to be continuously committing to lean on God. We acknowledge our feelings. We work through them and we pray through them and we talk through them always as best we can. But our hope is in the Lord. I hope that you know that. Right now, we're going to get ready to go have lunch together. Okay? We're going to go and I'm going to say a prayer here in a moment and then you'll be dismissed and you can go grab your lunch. There are a couple things that we're going to skip over that we might have done. There'll be no closing song today. Band, you guys can relax. But here's what I want you to think about. This is kind of a mission meal that brings focus to the missionaries we're sharing with. But church, I would like to challenge you not only to think about the missionaries we support and the faith that they are trying to show to others, but use this mission time as an opportunity for your faith to be strengthened too. Because some of you have had a week, and some of you are going to have a tough week, but right now, we get to sit down to a meal that you didn't prepare and that you don't have to clean up from. And we can sit down together and we can talk about the things of the Lord. If that's a celebration, then let's celebrate well. But listen, if you're low, if you're frustrated, I'm going to be hanging out up here for a little bit. Instead of waiting in line, why don't you come to talk to me? And I'd love to pray with you. And if there gets to be too many of you, we've got a couple elders that can talk and pray with you too. Because that's the amazing thing about God. Whether we're feeling great or feeling lousy, we know that our God is strong and sure and reliable. And we can turn to him with each other to find strength and to be able to stand up one day with a microphone or not, and tell our story about how God has always been there. So, I wonder if you'll pray with us one more time. We're going to pray that the Holy Spirit would come and just remind us of our salvation. And we're going to pray a prayer of thanks for the meal that has been prepared. And we're going to pray that we would be inspired to lean on God's foundation and not just our feelings. Could you pray with me? Thank you, God, for giving us emotions, for giving us the ability to connect with each other on such deep levels. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity that we have to sing and praise and worship and celebrate with each other, but also for the opportunity that we have to cry together, to talk together, to feel together, and to pray together. Thank you, Lord, for the emotional connections that we're able to build. And Lord, would you please help us? Help us to be mindful of our emotions and thoughtful about them and help us to connect to each other emotionally. But Lord, would you please help us not to be ruled by our emotions? Lord, we don't want to be ruled by anything but you because you are our King. Lord, you've saved us so that we don't have to be slave to sin. You've saved us so that we don't have to be slave to death. And Lord, we remember right now that you've saved us so that we don't have to be slave to our feelings either. Lord, we come to you now asking that you would connect us, help us to care well for each other, and help us to encourage each other in looking to you. Thank you, God, for this rich time together today. Lord, would you please bless this meal that we're about to eat? Bless all those folks who've had a hand in preparing it and setting everything up. I pray for all the logistics, just that all that stuff works well. I pray that you'll fill our bellies. And Lord, help us to remember as we sit around these tables and eat and as we visit in the lobby and Lord, help us to remember to talk about the deep things of life and the deep things of faith and not just the stuff on the surface, because Lord, we know that our emotions can take us deeper. Help us as we go there together. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Congregation, this has been a weird day as far as Sunday morning services go. If you're here with us for the first time, I'll tell you, I don't know exactly what's coming next week, but it won't be this. But thank you for being here. I trust that the Holy Spirit has been with you. I trust that God's been in it. And I trust that as you go, you'll be strengthened. So go be the church. Lunch is ready. Enjoy yourselves. We'll see you next time.